Good evening. I'm Lori Johnson. Airport security will be extremely tight this week after the terror plot to blow up a Northwest Airlines flight on Christmas Day. It now appears that plot was hatched in the Middle East country of Yemen, which is near Saudi Arabia. David Brody reports.
The suspect in the terror plot is talking, and he's pointing the finger directly at Al-Qaeda, operating out of Yemen. According to ABC News, 23-year-old Nigerian Umar Farouk Abdulmutallab spent months training for his Christmas Day suicide mission. And apparently, he has direct ties to an American-born radical cleric now living in Yemen. That cleric, Anwar Alaki, is also linked to the Fort Hood shooter who went on a rampage last month.
All the roads point back to Yemen. They point back to Alaki. I think it's a pretty deadly combination.
The terror suspect comes from a wealthy Nigerian family, lived in an upscale London neighborhood, and went to fancy schools. At some point along the way, he became a radical, and his father actually brought concerns about his own son to authorities. Abdulmutallab was even on a U.S. terror watch list, but he wasn't on the no-fly list. There will now be congressional hearings, even though administration officials are defending the process.
The system has worked really very, very smoothly over the course of the past several days.
Some beg to differ.
This is, in my view, probably one of the worst situations I've ever heard of. And to cast this as the system working is not really what the American public needs to hear.
Earlier, I spoke with CBN News terror analyst Eric Stackelbeck. I asked him how this could have happened since the suspect's own father had alerted authorities and he was on a no-fly list.
Abdulmutallab should have never been able to board this plane. This is a guy who was banned from entering Britain, which isn't exactly the picture of stringent visa requirements. Britain, there's a lot of Islamic radicals there. He wasn't allowed to enter Britain. U.S. officials knew about him for at least 2 years, and as you said, Lori, his father, who's a very prominent Nigerian, contacted the U.S. Embassy there and said, look, my son has jihadist views. I'm worried about him. He's a radical. Knowing all of this, and Mr. Abdulmutallab was on a terrorist watch list, not a no-fly list, but a watch list. He should have, in the very least, Lori, have been patted down at the airport through security. Then maybe they could have found the underwear bomb that he apparently was wearing on his person. This should have never happened. Fort Hood, a month ago, should have never happened. Right now, Islamic jihadists are probing our defenses, and they're finding weaknesses.
Mm-hmm. And he boarded the airliner in Amsterdam. How did he get past the screeners there?
Apparently, they didn't do a pat-down of his person. As I said, he is on a terrorist watch list. They should have, in the very least, patted him down, if not let him on the flight entirely. So that's a great question. How did he get on the flight? Nigeria, where he originated his itinerary, Nigeria is pretty notorious for lax airport security. Amsterdam, you would expect more of. The Dutch are usually pretty on point with airline security, but he was able to slip through and get on an airliner, and he tried to detonate this bomb over Detroit. It would have not only killed the 253 passengers on board, Lori, the debris that would have came out of the sky over Michigan could have very well killed several people, hundreds of people, mm-hmm. below on the ground.
Tell us more about Al-Qaeda and how that organization might have played a role in this attack.
The attempted bomber, Abdulmutallab, says that he was acting under orders of Al-Qaeda. Apparently, he spent a good deal of time in Yemen, where he met with Al-Qaeda operatives there. They apparently may have supplied him with the explosives that he used. Look, Al-Qaeda right now has really set up shop in Yemen. It's really been building over the past several years, Lori. Yemen is a real Al-Qaeda safe haven. It's got all the perfect qualities for a terrorist safe haven. Safe haven, number one, really weak central government. Number two, really medieval type infrastructure, not a very modern country at all. Number three, very rugged, very mountainous terrain, a lot of places to hide. Number four, very young, impoverished population. The unemployment rates are through the roof. A good deal of the population is actually under the age of 15. So it's really a perfect witch's brew for Al-Qaeda to set up shop there. And they've been doing it. A lot of U.S. officials believe that Yemen is really the new Afghanistan.
Okay, thanks, Eric. Well, as we mentioned, the terror suspect in the airliner bomb plot is said to have trained in Yemen. Eric has this look at why that country is so appealing to Al-Qaeda.
Over the past year, the U.S. military has targeted and killed several high-ranking Al-Qaeda leaders in the tribal regions of Pakistan. It's the latest area used by the terrorists to plan attacks against the West. Now, the group may already be turning to Plan B. The nation of Yemen contains neighborhoods familiar to Al-Qaeda, rugged, mountainous, and extremely tough to govern.
The Yemeni government, unfortunately, does not have a lot of control over the country. They have control over Sana'a and just right around the capital, and that's about it. And the rest of the country is pretty much lawless.
Terrorism expert Rudy Atala has worked extensively in the Arab and Muslim world. He says Yemen's instability has allowed Al-Qaeda to establish a foothold.
It's easy to buy weapons in Yemen. You can go to any arms bazaar and pick up anything you want. People flow in and out of there quite a bit.
Yemen shares a porous 1,000-mile border with Saudi Arabia to the north. Its long coastline is also a challenge to patrol, and as a result, Somali refugees often land from the nearby Horn of Africa. Although Saudi jihadists have frequently crossed into Yemen, Al-Qaeda remains a largely homegrown phenomenon there.
We subscribe to the theory that poverty and a weak economy will breed terrorism. Not a lot of people would subscribe to this, but we do.
Mohammed Al-Basha is a spokesman for the Yemeni embassy in Washington.
Yemen, 70% of the population is under the age of 25. 40% live under poverty line. And from that 40%, 20% live under $1 a day. And on top of all that, our oil reserves have depleted and the oil production has depleted. With all these factors, it's very challenging for the government to face the radicalization process.
Yemen and Al-Qaeda share a troubled history. It was off the coast of Yemen in 2000 where suicide bombers killed 17 U.S. sailors on the USS Cole. Yemeni fighters flooded into Iraq after the U.S. invasion in 2003, and some 100 of the 240 remaining inmates at Guantanamo Bay Prison call Yemen home. The latest incident saw 16 people killed last year when suicide bombers targeted the U.S. embassy in the capital city of Sana'a.
We're losing revenue from tourism. Ships are not coming to our ports because they're afraid of landmines, sea mines, and suicide attacks on the water. We're losing income from investments because foreign companies don't want to come invest when you have a threat from such Al-Qaeda.
The radicalization process in Yemen usually begins from within, as extremist clerics target the country's large pool of unemployed young men. These clerics' reputation reaches far beyond Yemen. The American terrorist who killed a U.S. soldier outside an army recruitment center in Arkansas this year had traveled to Yemen to study jihad.
The homegrown problem is a group of folks that are disgruntled with the Yemeni government and also want to see their brand of Sharia law dominate.
The Yemeni government has tried several different measures to counter the jihadist ideology. In 2007, it produced The Losing Bet, a film that aimed to warn Yemenis about the dangers of Islamic extremism. Some terrorists have also been placed in a government-run rehabilitation program that seeks to turn them away from radicalism.
If you have blood in your hands, you're going to be prosecuted to the full extent of the law. But if you don't have blood in the lands, you were conspiring, or we caught you in an early stage, we want to give you also a future.
But U.S. officials have questioned the program's effectiveness. They've also criticized Yemen for releasing terrorists, some wanted in the U.S., from prison. In 2006, 23 Al-Qaeda suspects escaped from a Yemeni prison. Most were eventually recaptured, but the incident strained relations between Yemen and the U.S.
The U.S. has increased its foreign aid to Yemen. But the Yemeni government has kind of dragged its feet on really going after Al-Qaeda.
Still, Al-Basha says the relationship between the two countries remains solid.
The U.S. also have helped us train our counterterrorism units, helped us with logistics. We share security and intelligence information, and it's been very steady, and the cooperation is good.
Yemen would like to see more U.S. money to help its counterterrorism efforts, but Atala says that won't guarantee better results.
We can throw a lot of money at a problem. It doesn't mean that the host nation is going to do the right thing.
9 Christian missionaries were kidnapped in northern Yemen in June. 3 of them were killed and the other 6 are still missing. Critics say the incident calls attention to the increasing destabilization inside Yemen, with the country facing an insurgency by Shiite rebels in the north and similar breakaway efforts in the south. The situation there could go downhill quickly, providing al-Qaeda with a chaotic atmosphere it may deem irresistible. Eric Stackelbeck, CBN News, Washington.
Opposition leaders say Iranian security forces rounded up at least 7 prominent pro-reform activists today. They're stepping up a crackdown on the country's pro-reform movement. The arrests come a day after 8 people were killed in anti-government protests. One of the dead is the nephew of the chief opposition leader. The violence is some of the worst since June's disputed presidential election that sparked weeks of demonstrations. A new survey looks at the most and the least religious states in America. Mississippi is the most religious. 82% say religion is very important. Alabama and Arkansas tied for 2nd, just ahead of Louisiana and Tennessee. At the bottom of the list, Vermont and New Hampshire with only 36%. The rest of New England, Alaska, and Colorado were also among the least religious states.
The doctor said to me, Peggy, you don't understand. Pancreatic cancer is inoperable and incurable. And he says, well, Peggy, you've got 2 months to live. It was like he was telling me, go to the store. There was no compassion. And that was heartbreaking. My life was an hourglass. I was home laying on the couch, just dying. My sister Pam called the Cancer Treatment Centers of America. When I got there, I knew that I was going to be cared for. I met with the doctor after the tests were done and said, how long do I have? And he looked at me and he said, Peggy, we did a lot of tests on you, and I never saw one thing stamped on the bottom of your foot that said you were going to die in 2 months. You have no expiration date. I thought, wow.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America is unlike any other cancer hospital, full of hope, committed to your fight. We use every weapon, surgery, chemotherapy, radiation, nutrition, spiritual support, and mind-body medicine. We surround you with a real team, working together, all under one roof.
Each time I went back to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America, I responded better. My tumors are shrinking. Came back in September again, and they still couldn't see anything. I said, you're kidding me. We'll see how it goes. We'll keep testing, but we can't see the tumors anymore.
Please call the number on your screen to speak with an oncology information specialist and receive a life-changing information kit and DVD packed with valuable information. Call now and learn about treatment options you may not even know exist.
It's really unbelievable how one doctor can tell me I have 2 months to live, and then I go to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America and they save my life. Hope is a mainstay. Hope is everything.
Don't give up. Your fight is our fight. Call Cancer Treatment Centers of America today.
The Department of Agriculture says 49 million Americans struggle just to put food on the table. But as Heather Sells reports, thousands of faith-based organizations are fighting back.
While America may be known as the land of plenty, millions find it difficult to buy groceries. Now, an army of faith-based and other nonprofits is making a difference.
People come to us looking for a well-balanced, nourishing kind of a meal.
First Lutheran in Norfolk, Virginia has teamed with other local churches to provide hot meals to the public. Lunch is served every day of the week.
For a lot of people, this is it. This is their only source of food.
The 15-year-old ministry helps many homeless people. And with today's economy, those numbers are growing.
People are becoming desperate, incomes are dropping, and they're relying on the grace of the churches and volunteers and the people in their community to support them.
Hey, when did you get laid off?
As high unemployment continues, many nonprofits are working overtime. Martha Gorman's church-based ministry helped 700 more clients this year than last. Food bag requests tripled. The problem, says Gorman, is not just job loss, but fewer hours and benefits.
And I have so many people that come in the door and say, I'm $2 over the limit for food stamps. And you think, what? And they have a family of four or five to feed.
Debbie Fava is one of those people. She works two jobs, 7 days a week, to provide for her disabled husband and daughter. But Debbie has a secret weapon, Angel Food Ministries.
Angel Food Ministries distributes 500,000 boxes of food to churches around the country each month. The restaurant quality food is offered at half price and available to anyone who orders.
I mean, at the end of each month, I'm having to look at what do I pay? I need to keep the power on, I need to have food. And just the opportunity to have food at a lower price has been an absolute blessing.
The $30 box has a little bit of everything. It's got the frozen vegetables, it's got the meat, it's got chicken breast, steak, cereal, eggs.
Kelsey lost his job at a furniture store months ago. He's now an experienced job seeker.
I've applied at jobs that I'm qualified for, underqualified for, overqualified for, and you know, it's just not a very good time to be job hunting.
So Angel Food, along with odd jobs and food stamps, is keeping Kelsey afloat for now. Kelsey, like so many Angel Food customers, wants no part of soup kitchens or food banks. In that respect, he's typical of many of today's hungry, people simply seeking a hand up.
It's not a giveaway. They have to buy it. So it's giving dignity to folks when they come in.
Helping the hungry can take many different forms. For example, Hunters for the Hungry takes advantage of Hunter's Bounty.
It's an age-old idea. Hunters bring in what they can't eat, butchers process it, and distribute the meat to local nonprofits.
It's quite a gourmet item. They're very expensive. If you go to buy farm-raised deer, it's in the $6-$7 pan range.
Across the country, hunters are catching the concept and bringing in high-quality protein that so many cannot afford. No one knows exactly how many nonprofits are meeting food needs, let alone how many individual Americans are helping their neighbor. But with the number of hungry at the highest level in years, these ministries are keeping stomachs full and no doubt nourishing hearts and minds as well. Heather Sells, CBN News.
Now, a special television offer on the award-winning film, Friends for Life.
I miss Grandma.
It's almost impossible to express the deep sense of loss.
My wife had made friends with a great gray wolf that often came into our backyard. Then I stumbled onto the wolf's core helpless pups.
I kind of adopted her pups.
At first, it seemed like another disaster, but it soon became a labor of love. When it came time to let them back into the wild, I wondered if I would ever see them again.
Hey, what's he doing? He's cleared out half the forest.
Jim, you have got to get to the wolf.
Let's see if we can't give Mr. Crawford a few headaches.
Rutgers has set traps all over in the hills.
At that moment, I knew I had friends for life.
It's really something, what you're doing for these folks.
You could never disappoint me, son.
Friends for Life is a family film that will touch your heart.
Grandpa, that lady just kissed you.
Yes, she did.
From the creators of the beloved TV series, The Life and Times of Grizzly Adams, this is a DVD every family will want in their home. You'll want everyone to share in this heartwarming story of love and hope, of experiencing the joy of helping those in need, and discovering a greater meaning of life itself. DVD bonus features include a candid behind-the-scenes look at working with the animals. Order your copy of Friends for Life today. To order your personal copy of Friends for Life, call 1-800-957-6286 or visit grizzlyadams.com. That's 1-800-957-6286 or visit grizzlyadams.com. 1-800-957-6286. Order your copy of Friends for Life today.
The Blind Side continues to be a big hit at the box office. The movie is based on the true story of a Memphis couple who brought a homeless boy into their home. Reporter Sean Brown interviewed Sean and Leanne Tuohy and the young man they helped, Michael Oher.
What is he wearing? It's below freezing.
Do you have any place to stay tonight? Don't you dare lie to me.
This was the moment in the hit movie The Blind Side and in real life when things began to turn around for Michael Orr.
Honey, you're changing that boy's life.
No. He's changing mine.
Michael was one of 13 kids growing up in the city of Memphis. His mother was a single parent with a crack addiction who was in and out of rehab. And because there was little supervision, Michael rarely went to school.
The closest thing Michael had to a father was his friend Steven's dad, Big Tony.
And then nobody wanted to really deal with Mike, you know what I'm saying? Because they said that he wasn't going to make it, never going to be nothing because where he comes from, you know.
Big Tony realized that if his son and Michael were ever going to make it, they needed to get out of the inner city schools. So he drove both 16-year-old boys across town to Briarcrest, a predominantly white Christian school. And there, he had met with an old friend, the school's basketball coach.
He shows up at Briarcrest, and I recognized him, and he came in and said he wanted to get his son into a Christian environment. I think that was one of the wishes of his mother. He wanted to get him into a Christian environment.
After becoming a student at Briarcrest, Michael had no idea of the challenges that lay ahead. He wasn't just a minority by race, but by size. At 6'4", 360 pounds, he was the biggest kid in the school, so he found it very hard to fit in.
Everybody around me was smart and had everything I wanted and needed, and I wanted to be a part of it.
Then he met Sean Tui. Sean was a successful businessman whose daughter Collins was in Michael's class.
I just think he looked a little bit out of place, and he shouldn't, and that's kind of what I was trying to make sure he knew that, you know, this, you don't have to be out of place. It's your choice. You know, people here want you to be part of everything that you want to be a part of.
Then one day, while Sean and his wife Leanne were driving across town, they saw Michael walking across the street.
And I remember driving just casually by him, going, oh, there's that guy I was telling you about. And I just kept going. And she grabbed me and said, you know, what's he doing? It was Thanksgiving vacation time, so there was no school.
You know, I just fell in love with the kid. I mean, I didn't care if he had a mother, father. You know, it didn't matter to me. I just wanted his life to be as comfortable as my other two children's.
Leanne would quickly learn just how uncomfortable a life Michael had been living.
Never had one before.
What, a room to yourself?
A bed.
Not only had he never had his own bed, Michael was basically homeless, so the Tuis offered him a place to stay. But it turned into much more.
Well, you have one now.
Michael became a part of the family.
She just acted like she cared or something like that, and wanted to do for me, and wanted to give. Never had that.
With the help of a loving family, Michael was able to bring up his grades. He played basketball and football for the school. He turned out to be a gifted athlete, and his coach believed he could go further. Michael's biological mother had died, so the Tuis adopted him. By the end of his senior year, Michael had improved his GPA to 2.6 and was accepted to the University of Mississippi on a full football scholarship, where he surprised everyone when he made the dean's list with a 3.1 GPA. 4 years later, he was drafted 13th overall in the 2009 NFL draft by the Baltimore Ravens.
I think that Michael's life, Michael's story, is so much more than what we do here. It really is about the million Michaels out there.
The Lord was in full control of all that, and that's why I just get excited sometimes to think what the future holds, because I know that this is all for a reason, and you know, it's kind of just kind of exciting sometimes to sit back and see his plan unfold. It's amazing how a child changes when he is clothed, hungry, and you feed him, and you educate him. I mean, there's a transformation in a child when you know, he's loved and full and smart, and he feels like he's on the same page with everybody else.
Thanks to God's love and the help of the Tuis, today Michael is finishing up his rookie season with the Baltimore Ravens. And his message to kids like him is, stay in school, work for good grades, and never give up, and you too can be successful in life. For CBN News, I'm Sean Brown.
great story that Americans love. The movie finished number 6 over the weekend with nearly $12 million, and it's likely to cross the $200 million threshold in the next few weeks, making it one of the highest grossing pictures of 2009. And we'll be right back.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart.
These are the most powerful songs of our time. And now, for the first time, the biggest praise and worship songs are together.
How great is our God.
Presenting Songs for Worship 50. 50 songs in one specially priced collection.
Holy is the Lord, God Almighty. The earth is filled.
You'll hear 50 beautiful songs of hope.
I'm coming back to the fire of worship. And it's
50 powerful songs of faith. Get Songs for Worship 50 on 3 CDs for only
$24.99.
But wait, order in the next 10 minutes with your credit card and we'll take $15 off. That's right, you get 50 praise and worship songs for just
$9.99.
Then preview other great praise and worship collections. Satisfaction guaranteed.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
So call now and get Songs for Worship 50. 50 beautiful songs on 3 CDs for just
$9.99.
Call 1-800-651-5798 to order Songs for Worship 50 on 3 CDs for $9.99 plus shipping and handling when you use your credit card. Call now or order online at timelife.com/songsforworship50.
Finally tonight, an Alaska father is giving God the credit for saving his teenage son's life. The boy suffered a severe brain aneurysm and only had a slim chance of surviving.
Jimmy, how you doing?
Pretty good.
17-year-old Jimmy Ray was given a second chance at life. His dad calls it a miracle.
God was with us the whole way, kept our family together.
Tragedy struck when Jimmy suddenly had an excruciating headache.
And it felt like someone was stabbing me in my eyes.
What happened was a blood vessel in his brain broke, and the aneurysm he had is fatal in 70% of people who don't get treatment.
It's so difficult that, you know, certainly surgeons can learn it, but it's very few people can practice it well.
And as if the surgery weren't difficult enough, Jimmy's case was especially challenging.
In this location, this is the largest aneurysm I've seen.
The surgery involved reconnecting blood vessels so Jimmy wouldn't have a stroke. It was a success, and now Jimmy's brain functions are completely restored.
And that's all the time we have for this edition of NewsWatch. We hope you'll join us again next time. Have a good evening.